Good morning. Welcome to all here in the sanctuary and on Zoom. It's nice to see you out on this cold, blustery day. We will begin the service with the prelude.
The answer is blowing in the wind. answer, my friends, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
So this week we will be celebrating Thanksgiving. Quickly coming up on a new year. So I will be reading a Psalm 111, 1-4, a Psalm of Thanks. I will thank the Holy One with all my heart, in talking with the earnest and whenever people gather. Your acts are vast beyond measure. All who delight in them marvel at their power. Majesty and splendor pour forth from creation. Your generosity endures for all time. You crafted your wonders to last forever. You overflow with compassion and grace. This Sunday, we'll be tying up the season of Cairn, the parables, and Jesus' journey to Jerusalem. And that's the heart of Luke's gospel. So instead of adding to the Cairn today, participants will be encouraged to take a stone with them, taking this message of community and God's love out into the world. We take these stones out into our lives, building signposts to remind ourselves and others that we follow the one who welcomed all, who ministered to the outcasts, the marginalized, and the unseen. We follow the one who asks us to join in that work of creating the kingdom of God here and now. Amen. So we light the peace lamp today, as we've been doing for years, as a reminder of peace that Jesus brings. When times get tough, it can be difficult to find peace. And many of us are going through some challenges and hard times right now. Whether that's finances, heart health problems, or a sense of anxiety or the state of the world, it can be difficult to find peace of mind. A minister, Joe McKeever, identifies three types of peace. Number one, peace with God is a gift of the Lord Jesus Christ. Number two, peace within oneself is a fruit of the Spirit. And three, peace between peoples is a work of righteousness. As a peace lamp is lit, may we all find peace within and peace among those in our lives. Let's pray. Dear God, as we seek to promote peace in your name, help us to have eyes that see the best in people, a heart that forgives the worst, a mind that forgets the bad, and a soul that never loses faith in you. Amen. So for our offering and giving, it's listed in the bulletin. If you want to give today, there's a basket back in the lobby for checks and cash. But the other ways are listed in the bulletin. Let's pray. Dear God, you are an abundant God, and out of your great mercy, you have given us so much. We give you this offering today. With it, we worship you and give our whole selves to you. Please now take it and use it for your kingdom and your glory. Amen. So this morning we have Emma and Eric Nord here today, and they're going to be participating. Andrea and Eric Nord participating with us today. For those who don't know them, they've been on Zoom many Sundays. They were attenders of our church for years, When their sons, Joel and Emma, were little, as I said this morning, little tykes. So they're not anymore. So Emma is at EMU, and apparently Joel is getting married soon. He's 22. So we will have a couple songs, and Eric's going to lead that. And then we'll just follow the bulletin, and as your turn comes up, please come forward.
Let's rise as you're able, and we'll sing number 114 together. Now thank we all our God.
Thank you.
Greetings, church. I also bring you greetings from Micheline, David, and Eviela. It is a privilege to be again part of the service this morning and share in the voice of the congregation. The past 11 months in Elkhart has been an experience to look at and thank God and praise Him. Coming into a new country, to a new place, new environment, meeting new people, trying to adjust and ensuring in the process that that which we have come here for, studies, is successful. We wouldn't be here at this moment if God hasn't allowed us. You as a church are a big part of this, and you have seen the journey this far. When we arrived, it was a big challenge because it was winter. But there were many people encouraging us. The kids went to school, they adjusted pretty well. And I also started doing well at school. I look back today, and the one thing which can come in mind is Job. Brother Job, when he says that, "I have heard of you, God, but now my eyes have seen you." I paraphrase that. That's what he meant, is that my faith has always been there, but what I see now is even coming to encourage, to strengthen, to give me more reasons not to quit, even when I see that things are not working well. We've trusted God every single step of being here, and our eyes have seen Him. Our eyes see all over the place God's signs, God's hand in our lives, and we thank Him. And that strengthens our faith in such a way that even what we haven't seen yet, we can continue trusting Him. And so I encourage you that your faith comes to a point where you look around and see signs of God's wonders in your life, like He has done to us. Greetings to you.
I'll be reading from Luke 17, verses 11 through 19. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well."
Yeah. Were you guys listening to the scripture reading that we just did? Did you hear them talking about lepers?
I heard them talking about lepers.
What do you know what a leper is? Who knows what a leper is? You do?
Someone who is sick with
leprosy. And we don't hear much about leprosy these days. It was a disease, and it was around back in the Bible times, and it's still around in some countries in the world. And it's not a good disease, and it can affect your skin, and you can get blotches on your skin. It can make you blind. You can start to lose the feeling in your skin. So when you touch things, you can't feel. And back in the day, people were very afraid of lepers because they were afraid if they would be with them that they would get the disease. And so they were treated very poorly. They were shunned to stay by themselves and away from the rest of the community. And they were called unclean. And they were even supposed to, when they go around, they were supposed to say unclean so people knew to stay away from them. And they were treated very badly. And I'm going to tell you a story about Mother Teresa. And you might have heard of, some of you might have heard of Mother Teresa. She was a woman who loved God very much. And she felt called to go to India and to minister to people that were poor and sick. And she did some ministry to lepers as well. Let's see if we can get this. Can you make sure I got focus on that window mic so I can advance? There we go. There's Mother Teresa. And this is the book I'm going to read you. And you can see some of the pictures up on the screen, as well as here. A caring mother. It says, Mother Teresa spent her life caring for people. She helped children learn. She gave food to people who were hungry and poor. And she gave medicine to people who were sick. She took care of people who were dying. And there you can see, there's young, her name when she was growing up was Agnes. And there's her with her mother when she was a child. Mother Teresa's name was Agnes. When she was growing up in Europe, Agnes was always a caring person. She helped to care for the sick neighbors. She helped a woman take care of her children. And she helped her mother feed hungry strangers. Agnes is the one in the middle there. She spent a lot of time at church. She went to the church school, and she sang in the church choir. When Agnes was 12 years old, are any of you out there 12 or older? You're older than 12. Are you? You're older than 12. She decided she would become a nun. A nun is a woman who gives up everything to serve the church. She's in the back row on the very right in this picture. And there she is as a young nun. Agnes joined a convent when she was 18 years old. She lived in the convent with nuns, and she learned to be a nun. Then she moved to India. Agnes became a nun and changed her name to Sister Teresa. Sister Teresa had everything she needed in her convent in India, but many people in India were very poor. The poor people lived in huts with mud floors, and they did not have enough food. Their clothes were rags, and Sister Teresa wanted to help them. Sister Teresa left the convent and she went to live with the poor people. She wanted to help. Sister Teresa lived in the slums of Calcutta, India. Slums are very poor areas of a city. in the slums. This my advancer isn't going. Sister Teresa taught the children. There she's with children. She gave medicine to the sick. And soon other nuns came to help Sister Teresa. Sister Teresa started her own group of nuns, and she became Mother Teresa. She was with a group that were called the Missionaries of Charity, and they wore white robes like that with blue lines. Mother Teresa and her nuns moved into a house together. They slept, ate, and prayed at their house. But they spent most of their days in the streets helping people. Mother Teresa saw many people dying. Come on. In Calcutta's streets, hospitals would not help these people because they could not pay. So there's many people that were sick, but they couldn't pay to be in a hospital. So Mother Teresa opened a house for the poor people who were dying. She believed that everyone should be cared for and loved. Mother Teresa also opened a home for orphans. These were baby children who did not have parents. Some of the children were very weak, and Mother Teresa cared for them and treated them as if they were her own family. In 1997, Mother Teresa received an important award for her work with the poor. She received the Nobel Peace Prize, which is a very important award. Mother Teresa said no one should feel unwanted. She cared about all the people, and she showed kindness and love to everyone. And there was a quote, I thought I had it on this page, but it disappeared. She had a quote that said, "Do small things with great love." And I thought that was important, and I thought it was important for you guys, because you guys, a lot of you guys are small, but even though you're small, you can still do small things if you have great love in your heart. So let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for the example of Mother Teresa, who cared for those who were sick and were dying, and those that some people would call untouchable. Thank you that she did everything out of love for you. Help us to be able to see where we can do small things with great love. Amen. Thank you.
Doing small things with great love. That's what this journey is about, isn't it? Well, I invite you to pause for a moment and to take a full breath to receive the Spirit, the one who gives this love to us. And join me in prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, as Doug mentioned as we began our service this morning, we are finishing up this journey that we've been on for the last couple months. This journey where we have been following Jesus on the way to Jerusalem, winding our way with him through some challenging terrain. And I want to back up for a second and look at this journey of Jesus from a little bit of a bird's eye view. Because for much of the Gospel of Luke, this Gospel, Luke, is where we have been for the last few months. For much of Luke, this writer follows the writer of Mark's Gospel, follows that same outline, a Gospel that was written earlier than Luke's and likely used as a template. Both Gospels follow Jesus' public ministry, beginning in Galilee, where Jesus calls the disciples, does miracles, preaches and teaches, comes into conflict with the religious leaders. And then Jesus heads to Jerusalem. Jerusalem, that place of crucifixion, of death, and new life. Well, the most significant structural difference between Mark and Luke's gospel is what is variously called the travel narrative or the journey to Jerusalem. In Mark's gospel, we first learn about Jesus heading towards Jerusalem in one chapter, and then just a half a chapter later, Jesus arrives. In Luke's gospel, though, Jesus heads and starts towards Jerusalem in the end of chapter 9, and he doesn't arrive for 10 chapters. In Luke's gospel, Jesus does not head straight for Jerusalem, but instead moves around from place to place. All right, I'm not sure what I did here. I have a red dot on here. Did you do that or did I do that? Oh, well. Maybe I'll just point at you, Joel, when we're ready for the next one. But I want you to take a look at this for a second, because Jesus stops and connects all along the way. He connects with the people around him. He stops and connects, healing and telling stories. It's as if he's leaving markers, like cairns, as he moves from place to place. As he moves from town to town, he's teaching his disciples and the many he meets about this love for everyone, especially the lost and the outsider. Well, in a story that we rarely read in the gospel, not today's story, but at the very beginning of this journey to Jerusalem, Jesus sends messengers ahead to make ready. And when they enter a Samaritan village and are not welcomed, James and John, his closest followers, ask almost offhandedly, "Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" It's incredible. James and John are ready to annihilate an entire village, a place that doesn't fit their understanding of who the kingdom of God is for or what it's about. Jesus rebukes his disciples in that story and moves on to another village. He moves on, place to place, building cairns, leaving markers and signposts of God's love along the way. He tells parables and stories over and over to shake up his listeners, inviting them to see in new ways, to give up their tightly held beliefs and ways of seeing in the world, to make space for something new. These 10 chapters of the travel narrative, they contain most of the parables that we've been looking at in the recent months. The rich fool, the rich man and Lazarus, the persistent widow, the Pharisee and the tax collector. And they also contain these memorable stories. The story of today of Jesus healing the 10 men with leprosy and last week's story of Zacchaeus. Well, last week we heard Jesus tell Zacchaeus and the crowd, "The Son of Man came to seek and save the lost." You see, this section of Luke's gospel that's sometimes called the travel narrative is also known as the gospel for the outcast. The gospel for the outcast. since so many of the stories and parables relate to God's love for the lost and the outsider. Well, through this journey with Jesus, we've been hearing about signposts of God found in our ordinary lives. We've been building a cairn as a reminder to ourselves and to others that we're not alone, that Christ holds our stories, our hopes and our dreams, our stumblings and our failures, our backtrackings, and sometimes even where we get lost. Christ holds our lives and asks us, welcomes us to journey with him. Well, in our scripture today, though lumped together as 10 who came seeking Jesus, really each of those lepers was on their own journey. Each one stepped out in faith as an outcast, as Joel called them. And when Jesus told them, go and show yourself to the priests, they headed toward the temple of their faith. Likely the Samaritan headed toward Mount Gerizim. Mount Gerizim was the place where Samaritans considered their holy place. It's where their temple was. It's where their priests were. So likely the Samaritan headed towards Mount Gerizim while the others headed towards Jerusalem, where the temple was of the Jews. But it's while they're on their way that the healing happened, not before the journey began. And it's then that the leper in our story, that Samaritan, who likely, it sounds like, was traveling alone, turned around. I wonder if that Samaritan leper, the foreigner, now clean from his death sentence, if he stopped and built a marker, a cairn, in the way Abraham and others marked sacred spaces, those thin places where they experienced God's presence. I'm curious for you, over these weeks we've heard signposts from different folks, but what are the markers of your lives? Or should I ask, where are the markers in our lives? How do we leave signs of God's presence for us to remember and for others to see? Why, where, how do we make visible and stop and give thanks for the ways we experience God on this journey? These cairns, these signposts, they're not built of one solid rock, but they're built of many broken pieces of stone, broken things used to build something new. Well, as Doug said, today we're going to start dismantling the cairn. You'll be given the opportunity to come up and take one of these stones, a symbol that might be a reminder for you of God's love with you on the journey, might be a symbol for you of the work yet to be done, an outer sign that's informed by an inner seeking. We will take these signs out into the world of the one who welcomes the outcast, the sinners, the rich leaders, and the hurting women. Take these as signposts. Well, I want to tell you a story of what I heard as a signpost in the last couple weeks. It really resonated with me. It's about outcasts, or those who once in their lives, in their history, were considered marginalized, and it's a story of hope and love in very tangible ways. You see, in southeastern Washington state, there in that red area, tucked off a dusty desert road, is the Yakima Reservation, the Yakima people in southeastern Washington. And if you drive down that road past fields of spindly hop plants and apple orchards, just on the edge of that reservation, there's a farm that for nearly a century has been an unlikely bridge between two American communities, a signpost for their resilience and mutual generosity. You see, in the face of discrimination and hate, the Inabas, a Japanese-American family, and the Yakima Nation forged a bond through farming that has really blessed them all. When Lou Inaba, who's now 67, third generation of his family to manage the farm, when Lou was ready to retire a couple years ago and sell the farm that's long been a family treasure, several options, several lucrative options came to his mind. But then Mr. Inaba remembered. He remembered the many acts of kindness that Yakima tribal leaders have shown his family over the years, acts that allowed his family to begin over and over again, starting when his grandfather arrived in Wapato, the town nearby, arriving in Wapato in the early 1900s, coming from Japan seeking a better life. Well, by the time Lou's grandfather, Tsukichi Inaba, arrived in Wapato in 1907, it had already been about a half a century, since the federal government had pressured the Yakima tribe to cede by treaty more than 10 million acres of their ancestral home. So that picture went from being over 10 million acres down to what they have today. Well, when Tsukichi Inaba arrived, together with his brother, they started clearing sagebrush on a plot that was leased to them from the Yakima Reservation. And they found success farming hay and potatoes and wheat. By the 1930s, less than 30 years later, as many as 1,200 Japanese people, many of them already American citizens, had settled nearby and built a thriving community around their Buddhist and Methodist churches and Japanese language school. But their success stirred resentment. Many of the Japanese farmers, including the Inabas, saw their lives upended in 1921 when the Washington State Legislature banned aliens, including people of Japanese ancestry, from leasing land. And again, it was a Yakima tribal member who told the family not to worry, that they could still farm a portion of his land. Then, if that wasn't enough, in early 1942, following the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, President Franklin D. Roosevelt signed an executive order which sent more than 100,000 American citizens and other residents of Japanese ancestry to incarceration camps. Given the label number 33120, the Inaba family spent more than 2 years here at the Heart Mountain incarceration camp in Wyoming. The Inabas were among the few Japanese American families who returned to Wapato after they were released. They found that their farm had been taken over, their new car had fallen into disrepair, and signs reading, "No Japs Wanted," dotted the area. And yet, with the help of several Yakima tribal members and white neighbors, the Inaba family started over. Once again, another Yakima man carved out a parcel so that the Inaba family could rebuild their farm. "If it wasn't for the Indian Nation, we would never have been able to be here," recalled Mr. Inaba's mother, Shiz Inaba, who's now 93 years old. Well, hold that story of the beginnings of how the Inabas started over and over with the help of the Yakimas. And it's now that the Yakima Nation approached Mr. Inaba and expressed interest in buying the farm. Now a 1,600-acre farm that supplies top grocery chains all around the country. The Yakimas saw this as a purchase, as an opportunity to improve the community's access to healthy produce. Mr. Inaba calculated that selling to the tribe would mean that he would receive a lot less for the land, but he knew it was the right thing to do. Different tribal members were very kind to our family and to the entire Japanese community over the years, he said. This could be a way to repay them. And so after a couple years of negotiations, last year the tribe purchased the farm. Virgil Lewis, who was then the vice chairman of the Yakama Nation Tribal Council, said that the parallel struggles of the Japanese American community and the Yakama Nation has contributed to a sense of historical solidarity. I like that, a historical solidarity, one in need helping another along the way. Well, on a recent autumn afternoon on this farm, about a year after the sale, music blaring on the farm speakers as workers from Mexico and Guatemala packed pumpkins into cardboard crates, a Haitian man zipping around on his forklift, and several young members of the Yakama Nation brought on to learn how to run the farm from the Inhabas. They're moving between all these places. In between that, in the center of the packing floor, sat a stack of boxes emblazoned with a new name, Yakama Nation Farms. Since acquiring the farm, the tribe has been experimenting with different ways of distributing produce to the community, including through donations and subscription boxes. You see, it's part of the tribe's broader vision to give people more control of their food supply and their nutrition. There have been lots of hurdles along the way, such as developing farm expertise through the Yakama Nation, because generally they have been ranchers and fisher people. But both the Yakama and the Inhabas are determined to make this project a success. Lou Inhaba said he would work for two more years to help with the transition and was prepared to stay longer if needed. I really think we owe it to him. I really think we owe it to them, Mr. Inhaba said. We've had it tough for 75 years. They've had it tough for 600. That's a big story of two communities helping one another. But that story, kind of like Joel talked about at the very end of Children's Time, of it being small acts that make the difference. This story was made up of many small acts of reaching out and supporting one another. Kind of like the building of stones that show the way of love. Well, really, this journey of love begins here inside each one of us. Jesus' journey is not one simply of finding the right path or the road to follow. Jesus asks for an inner transformation, a journey that asks us to go inside, to listen for the movement of the Spirit, and then to step out, setting up our stones and our guides, our inner attitude impacting our outer vision. Stones that mark the journey. Next week, we'll begin the season of Advent, believe it or not, where that inner journey through darkness and waiting will be a new way we walk the path. But now, this week, we continue to consider how we are beckoned onto this journey of life. What is the inner journey asking of you? And in response to that, how are you called to bring your stone, your signpost, into the world?
Thank you.
Well, we will be bringing our sharing time to a close while Sally plays music. I invite you to come forward if you choose to and take a rock. Take home a stone with you. It might be a marker for you that simply reminds you that you are loved and known and not alone. It might be a challenge to continue to build signposts in your world. However you choose to take a stone, come and take one home with you as a marker for the world. Thanks for blessing us, Sally. Wondering if we have any announcements to share with the community today. And sprinkled in there, if you have birthdays or anniversaries, we'd love to know them as well. I don't see Bethany here, so I'll go ahead and make an announcement, just reminding everyone that Bethany will be leading an intergenerational activity. So for kids and anyone else who wants to, they will be downstairs making stars. You can stay for that. You can join us here for a discussion about the sermon and the rest of the service. And then please stay also for our potluck, which will start at about 12:15-ish today.
Leah Witzig, I turned 73 tomorrow, and my daughter and younger granddaughter are coming in from Denver, will arrive tonight and will be with us tomorrow. Then they head up to West Point to have Thanksgiving with my older granddaughter. So happy time.
A birthday of Leah. Anybody else with birthday this week? Well, does somebody want to lead us in singing? Start us off.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, Leah. How about any visitors with us this morning?
I'm here virtually, and we're finally reunited with Abena and her family. They've come to spend the week before and be here for Thanksgiving. So everybody, we're happy.
Beautiful.
Yeah. Oh, hi, we're so happy to be here. Wish we could have been in person, but we are unfortunately the children of a scientist.
Well, glad you are here in State College. Well, welcome everyone, and please stay for coffee and tea, and then shortly after 11:30, we will gather back here for conversation. We are going to end our service today with a song. I invite you to stand and hear these words as we go forth. My friends, as you take these stones, these signposts into your lives, may you go in love, for love alone endures. Go with peace, for it is the gift of God. And go with courage, for we cannot go where God is not.
Thank you.